John chapter 20, post-resurrection season. Post-resurrection season. You've got post-baseball season. You got post-basketball season, post-football season. That just means the season's over. It means it happened. We're moving on to something else. Football finishes, and what do we go to after football? Is it basketball, right? Switch over to basketball or hockey, I guess, if you're in a hockey. Any hockey fans right here? Y'all are hockey. Yeah, y'all from the other part of the continent up there where it's cold all the time. You got baseball, soccer, football. You've got a sport. When the sport's over, season's over, you move on to something else. What I want to challenge you this morning is about the resurrection. First of all, the resurrection celebration ought to never be over. It ought to be an every week thing. We're not going to always sing Easter songs every Sunday morning. But we gather every Sunday morning, and the reason we gather on Sunday mornings, we assemble on Sunday mornings, is because Jesus rose again that first day of the week. Every week, it's a commemoration of Him rising again. But Easter happened today, or Resurrection Sunday, if you want to call it that. I don't get into those arguments. A lot of people do. I'm going to stay away from that. I'm going to use Easter to see as many people saved as we can. Call it Resurrection Sunday. I'll call it Easter Sunday. I'm not going to get into that. We had a great candy hunt today. We had a lot of people come to church because of that. People got saved. I'm not going to get into that argument. But Easter is here today. Tomorrow it's over. What do we do? What did the disciples do? Jesus came. They followed Him. 3.5 years they were following Him as His disciples, as He made them to be apostles. He died. He was buried. 3 days later, He rose again. 40 days later, I believe it's 40 days, 40, 50 days, and He's gone. The 40 days he left, and then 50 days you had Pentecost, He's gone. What do you do after that? What do you do after the resurrection? What do you do after the great climax of Christianity happens? Well, that's what I want to preach about tonight. John chapter 20, if you would. I'm going to give you several thoughts. I think I've got five. We'll see what we get through tonight. Kind of more of a Bible study. I want to teach you. I want to help you as Christians and as a church. I want to help our church be prepared to do what we're supposed to do after the resurrection. John chapter 20, verse 19. The Bible says this. Then the same day at evening, this is right after Jesus rose again. He rose again that morning. This is the same day. The same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst, and saith unto them, Peace be unto you. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Then were the disciples glad when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus unto them again, Peace be unto you, as my Father sent me, even so send I you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. Whosoever sins you retain, they are retained. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, We've seen the Lord. But he said unto them, Except I shall see the hands in his hands, the prints of the nails, and put my finger into the prints of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. I want to give you some thoughts about what to do after the resurrection. I want you to see, first of all, from John chapter 20, verse 19, the Bible says that they were together, the doors were shut where the disciples were. What's the next word there? Chapter 20, verse 19, the disciples were assembled. They assembled. What do you do after Resurrection Sunday? Well, you keep assembling. You keep coming to church. You keep meeting. Let's look at this passage. I want you to see, first of all, that Thomas missed out because he wasn't part of the assembly. Everybody else was together. The Lord has risen. They hadn't seen him yet. Mary had seen him. Now they're together. They're in this room. The doors are closed for fear of the Jews. Jesus had just been crucified for what he was preaching. And they're afraid that they're going to come after them next. They close the doors. And while they are assembled together as believers, Jesus appears right there in the middle of them. But Thomas wasn't there. And because Thomas wasn't there, Thomas missed a blessing. Now, this is not the what do you call it, the preaching to the choir. You're here on a Sunday night. I'm not preaching at you because you're here. I'm just saying, keep assembling. Keep going. Keep living for the Lord. Keep doing what you're supposed to do. Keep being here whenever you're supposed to be here. Thomas missed out because he wasn't part of the assembly. When he missed out of the assembly, or when he missed the assembly, he missed Jesus. This is a great important point to get here. When you miss the assembly, you're going to miss that meeting where God comes and God meets with his people. John 20:24, the Bible says, but Thomas, one of the 12 called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. I've been at some church meetings. I believe this morning was a church meeting where Jesus came. We saw lives transformed this morning. We don't see all the results of it. That comes later. But we saw people who came to a place. They didn't know anybody. Maybe a couple people that followed up with them. They came to a place, they heard the gospel, and trusted Jesus Christ as their Savior. A whole bunch of people today. Jesus showed up today. God was here in power today. I'm so glad I didn't miss today. Aren't you glad you didn't miss that? Thomas missed. He missed out because he wasn't part of the assembly. When he missed the assembly, he missed Jesus. In verse 25, everyone was talking about how Jesus met with them, but Thomas didn't believe him. Being the one that doesn't make it to that service. I've heard some preachers or some people, they'll go to just a great revival service and they'll come back and talk about how wonderful it was. And I've thought, I wish I would have made it to that. You know, every Sunday morning, every Sunday night has the potential for God meeting with you, for God doing a work in your heart through the preaching, through the fellowship, through the encouragement of the body of Christ. John 20:25, the other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. Yeah, right, you saw the Lord. That was his response. He didn't see him. He wasn't part of the assembly. He missed, it wasn't a service, but you see kind of the connection that I'm making here. It was an assembly. He missed that assembly. Jesus shows up. He doesn't see them. And then everybody else is saying, Thomas, if only you would have been here. He was dead. He's alive. And Thomas says, unless I put my fingers in those nail holes and I put my hand in his side, I'm not going to believe that he rose again. Everybody else was talking about it. He missed it. He didn't believe them. Then the next time Jesus showed up at the assembly, it was 8 days later, Thomas was there. I love this because I love it when somebody, even if they're not here for a long time, they feel like they can come back the next time. Yeah, they were missed, but they're treated like they were never gone. Okay? Thomas comes back and he wasn't shunned. It wasn't like, oh, you missed the first time, so you're really not part of the group anymore. It wasn't like, well, give us the secret handshake or knock or whatever it is. He was welcome. He was just part of the group. He comes in. So 8 days later, verse number 26, and after 8 days again, the disciples were within and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. Jesus shows up. Thomas is there. Then look what happens in verse 27. Then saith he to Thomas, Jesus is talking to Thomas, reach hither thy finger and behold my hands. Reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. He believes. He sees Jesus now. He knows Jesus rose from the dead. He's getting a blessing from being right there in the presence of Jesus. Jesus saith unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. Thomas grew in faith when he was part of the assembly. What do you do after the resurrection? You keep assembling. We keep doing what we did today. We keep going out soul winning. We'll talk about that in a moment. But we keep coming to church. We come to church on Sunday morning. We're here on Wednesday. Sunday night. Easter Sunday night is a hard service to get to. I know that. Because a lot of families are doing a lot of things. Some of you probably had to leave some type of a family event to get here to go to church on Sunday night. This is a hard service to get to just because all the other things going on. Driving to my parents' house, I'm driving by, I saw families, some of them pitching horseshoes, some of them having barbecues. Just, it's a family time. And I just want to say, you came tonight, you assembled, keep doing that. Being part of the assembly of Christians is critical to your Christian growth. Look at Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24. Turn there, I told you it's kind of a Bible study night. Go with me there, Hebrews 10, 24. All right, and while you're turning there, just a quick unrelated survey. How many of you had more candy today than you should have? Anybody? All right. And I didn't have a lot of candy. Eric's like both hands. How many of you? It wasn't candy, but it was more sugar than you should have had. More carbs, maybe. All right. Okay, don't raise your hand if I'm going to make you embarrassed or anything. But if I could raise my hand in both feet, I would. And I know it's a challenge after a day like today to focus on it. That's why I stopped for a moment. Hebrews chapter 10 now. You ready? Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 24. We together now? And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. Hebrews 10, verse 25. Now, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Talk about the assembly just for a moment. At the assembly, we're provoked to love God and to love others. You know, that's the two greatest commandments. You come to church and you're going to get provoked. That's kind of like poked a little bit, all right? It's poked with the vow in the middle of it. It's provoked, all right? Easy way to remember. It's a little bit poked. Provoked to love somebody, to love God. I'm challenged to love God. Maybe not just from the pulpit, but maybe from somebody else, maybe one of your friends, maybe encouragement, maybe a lady, part of the secret sister, getting a gift or giving a gift. And you get provoked to love somebody. The two greatest commandments, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There's none other commandment greater than these. The two greatest commandments you are provoked to do just by coming to church. And as you continue to assemble, you're going to continue to be provoked. Now this provoked is provoked in a good way, not like poking sticks at dogs, right? Not like whenever I was a kid, not like throwing rocks at wasps' nests in swing sets. That provokes them, and they do sting and they do hurt. And right there sometimes they'll sting you. Or right there, I think I got one. It's not that kind of provoking. It's a loving, hey, let's love God, let's love each other. Kind of like a pep talk maybe. At the assembly, we're provoked to love God. We're provoked to love others. At the assembly, we're provoked to do good works. It's a motivation to do right and an instruction to do right. That's part of what the assembly is about. At the assembly, we receive exhortation, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. What did they do? The resurrection happens, and they assembled. They just continued assembling. What a great reminder to us. Just keep on assembling. Just keep on coming to church. Great victory. Great victory today. You know, sometimes after the great victory is when people fall off and stop coming. I don't understand it, except that there's a spiritual battle going on. And just don't stop. Just keep assembling. Okay, there's a few more I want to give them to you. Look at Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. I'm going to kind of give you maybe the light version of a couple of these points here, because I want to get them all to you. But there's a lot of scripture involved in these, so we may not read all of them. But let me give you some of the thoughts here. Jesus has died. He's risen again. He's ascended up to heaven. Acts chapter 2, verse 14, the Bible says, but Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, talking to all the people there in Israel, ye men of Judea and all ye that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you and hearken unto my words. What's he doing? He's sharing the gospel. This was a sharing the gospel to a lot of people listening to him at the same time. Sometimes we're going to see in the book of Acts, they shared the gospel just one-on-one. We're not going to go through all of them, but you got Philip, and he shares the gospel with the guy, the servant from Ethiopia. Lots of people sharing the gospel after the resurrection. Peter stands up, and he starts to do that, and he says, Acts chapter 2, verse 21, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. What a great verse to use in sharing the gospel. Acts 2:32, this Jesus hath God raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. Now when they heard this, this is the people that were listening, they were pricked in their hearts. I lost my place. Hold on, there we are. Verse 37. And said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent, be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Just a little comment there. This isn't get repent and get baptized in order to have remission of sins. It's like if you had a wanted poster that says wanted for murder, you don't want somebody so that they can murder. You want somebody because they committed a murder. All right? So wanted for murder. Do you see where I'm going with this? It's not, hey, we want somebody to murder. No, it's he's wanted because he murdered. And Peter, he says, look, come out, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins. Get baptized, show that your sins are forgiven. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Anyway, he's sharing the gospel. What do we do after the resurrection? Let's share the gospel. Let's keep telling people about Jesus. Let's keep going out. Wouldn't it, the worst thing we could do after a day like today is to say, great, we've reached our quota of people getting saved for the year. We sure saw a lot of people saved this week. And God, thank you for doing that. But now we can just kind of kick back and not see anybody saved for a while because we saw, no, that is exactly the wrong thing to do. Let's keep going out. Let's keep sharing the gospel. Peter goes out and the other disciples, and they start telling people about Jesus. If you read in the details there, this is where they're talking to lots of people, and people are hearing it all in their own languages. People are getting saved right and left. 3,000 people get saved and get baptized because of them going out and sharing the gospel after the resurrection. Wouldn't that be awesome? Look, 12 people, maybe 120, kind of depending on which group it was that actually went out. Let's say it was 120. 120 people. They go out after the resurrection, and they start sharing the gospel. And within two chapters of the book of Acts, 3,000 people getting saved and baptized. It's the same God dealing with the same problem of sin. We can see people saved. We just need to go out and share the gospel. After the resurrection, let's keep assembling. After the resurrection, let's keep sharing the gospel. And look at verse 41. I want you to see that they followed up with their new converts. These people got saved. Acts 2:41. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized in the same day. There were added unto them about 3,000 souls. That is awesome. In one day. Verse 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers. Look at verse 46. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. What's happening? All these people are getting saved, and now they don't have a church building. They didn't get saved because there was a church building. These people are just getting saved, and there's a follow-up program happening. I don't know what it looked like. I don't know that it looked like ours, but they were going out, and they were taking these new converts. They just gotten saved, and they're going, and they're talking with them, and they're fellowshipping with them, and they're having dinner with them, and they're being hospitable towards them, and they're getting to know the people that just got saved. They're following up with their new converts. The resurrection just happened. They're assembling. They're sharing the gospel. And what are they doing? They're following up with their converts. What a great thing to do the week after Easter. Follow up with the people that God saved. And you can bet we're going to be doing that Tuesday night. If you come out on Tuesday night, there's a great chance that you're going to be able to deliver a pie to somebody that got saved this week in church. Let me encourage you to be here Tuesday night if you possibly can. Here's an opportunity to do what the disciples did after the resurrection. I don't know that they took pies because the Bible says they were breaking bread. But breaking a pie open is pretty good too. Whether they invite you in to break the pie with, let's just coin that phrase right there, breaking pie, all right? And taking it in, just delivering it to them. Knock on the door, hey, thanks for being here. It was just an honor to have you. Look, we want to give you this gift. You know, we've had a lot of people saved because of those little pies that we'll take. Some of them are even not cooked very well. I tell you, I promise, I've cooked a lot of them, and I've scraped some of the burnt crust off of them. Some of you probably scraped the rest off after I took it to your house. It's an amazing thing. What happens whenever somebody cares enough to go back and say, you came to church Sunday, we know she got saved, you trusted Christ as your Savior. Can we give you a gift just to say thank you? Maybe give them a little Bible study to follow up with. They followed up on their new converts. Look at chapter 3, verse 1. We're just a couple here. Peter and John are walking up to the temple together, okay? Peter and John, Acts 3, 1, went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. It had been about, I wrote that down. I forgot what time that was. 3 p.m. So afternoon, they're walking to the temple together, and a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful. This gate of the temple called the Beautiful Gate, right? And this guy has been carried because he can't walk. He's being carried to ask alms of them that enter into the temple. That's to beg. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. So here's the point I want you to follow along. They've been assembling. They've been sharing the gospel. They've been following up with their new converts. And now you're going to see this. They have a good testimony among the non-Christian people, the non-believing people. You can say the unchurched people if you want to. And I want you to see this good testimony. Peter and John, they're walking up toward the temple together. This man asks them for money. He says, "Can you give me something?" He asks for an alms. And Peter, verse 4, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. I want you to notice that they weren't too busy to bring someone to Jesus. We'll see how they did that in a moment. But in verse number 6, then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." They weren't too proud to admit they didn't have what the man wanted. They got a good testimony. You're going to see this testimony and how it reaches thousands of people. They're walking up to the temple. The man says, "Could you give me some money?" They're going to bring him to Jesus. But in doing so, they admit, Peter says, "I don't have anything. My pockets are empty. I don't have anything to give you. Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And then they gave him what he really needed. Verse 7, he took him by the right hand, lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And then, I love this part, they walked with him to the temple. They were walking to the temple together, Peter and John, just by themselves. They meet a man. This man has a need. They don't give him what the man wants, but they give him what the man needs. The man rises up, he walks, a miracle happens, and here's what didn't happen. They didn't say, "Okay, now leave us alone because we're going up to the temple together. You know, us buds, you know, we know our secret handshake and you don't, so you can't go with us." It's amazing how many times we, as Christians, we kind of get this just us and nobody else type of a mentality. They saw him there. They have a good testimony. They share Jesus with him. Jesus does a work in his life. He stands up, and they walk to the temple together. It's in verse number 8. "And he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple." Something's going on. This man, he's the one that's a beggar. He's the one that can't walk. And here he is walking to the temple with Peter and John. "And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him." And then you're going to see that God's influence in this stranger's life begins attracting attention. How can I be a good testimony? Well, just share Jesus with somebody. Let Jesus work in somebody's life. Accept them into your I saw the commercial, the Staples Inner Circle commercial. How many of y'all seen that one? I'm the only one? Me and Destiny, the only ones. And Janice, thank you for helping me with that. Let them into this group. Walk to the temple, spend some time with them. And here's what's going to happen. The work that God does in their life is going to begin attracting attention. Look at what happens here. Verse number 11. "And as the lame man, which was healed, held Peter and John..." Now, not only are they allowing him to walk with them, he's holding them. It's like, I can just picture this. Peter and John were walking to the temple, you know, kind of talking casually. Now that this has happened, they've got this man in between them. He probably doesn't smell the best. Probably not really attractive looking. He's a beggar. And I just picture him between them. "Hey, guys, this is great." You know, walking in. The Bible says he's walking and leaping and praising God. And Peter and John on both sides kind of looking past him and going, "Wow, you know, what did we get ourselves into today?" But they're going in together, and they're drawing a crowd. "And the lame man, which was healed, held Peter and John. All the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering." Now we've got a huge crowd looking at what God has done, the influence of God on this man. And then they use the opportunity to share the gospel. Verse 12, "When Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, 'Ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we made this man to walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But ye denied. Peter is bold. But ye denied the Holy One and the just, and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and killed the Prince of Life, whom God hath raised from the dead, whereof ye are witnesses. He's just going into the gospel. They're walking into the temple with this guy. He's been healed. God's done this amazing work in his life. And as these people come together, Peter just goes into the gospel. He doesn't pull any punches. He just shares the gospel clearly with them. This morning on the way in the church, I was a little bit late coming to Sunday school, trying to get our teacher's meeting done and get a few things done. And I was going to run over and pick up Anthony, then run back to church and just kind of trying to get a lot squeezed in. On the way to church, Anthony said this, I'm very excited. I'm very nervous. Then he said, I've got a lot of friends that I want to tell about this church. He hadn't even been here yet. And as I was studying this, I thought, wow. When God does a work in somebody's life, there's going to be people that come, and there are going to be people that notice, and they use the opportunity to share the gospel. Look at verse number 3. I'm sorry, Acts chapter 4, verse number 3. It's the same story, just a new chapter. And they laid hands on them. This is the leaders of the Jews. They're very upset that they're teaching about Jesus. They're very upset that they're healing in the name of Jesus. They laid hands on them and put them in hold unto the next day. They arrested them for it, for now it was eventide. Howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of the men was about 5,000. God blessed their efforts, and 5,000 people got saved. Why? Because they had a good testimony. What do you do after the resurrection? You just have a good testimony among the people that don't go to church. You just keep working at it. Kind of the same thing a lot of you have been doing already. Keep sharing the gospel. Keep being a good witness. Keep doing whatever you can to bring people to Christ. God will bless that effort. I want you to see in Acts chapter 4:21, we're going to have to be done, but I want you to see that they prayed. Acts 4, verse 21, so when they had further threatened them, this is the same story, the leaders of the Jews are threatening them because of their teaching in the name of Jesus. When they further threatened them, they let them go, finding nothing how they might punish them because of the people. For all men glorified God for that which was done. For the man was above 40 years old. He was an old guy on whom this miracle of healing was showed. And being let go, they went to their own company and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said unto them. Then look what happens in verse 24. And when they heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord and said, Lord, thou art God which hast made heaven and earth and the sea and all that in them is. And they go on into this prayer. I want to give you four thoughts about this. It's going to be very, very fast. First of all, the Bible says they lifted up their voice to God with one accord. After the resurrection, what do? They prayed as a united church. They prayed as a one church body with one accord, lifting their voices to God. They're together. They're together in purpose. They're together in suffering. They're together in doctrine. And as they pray, they're united. In verse 29, you see that they prayed for boldness to continue through the hardships. It's interesting. They didn't pray for God to remove the hardships, but they prayed for boldness through the hardships. Acts 4:29. And now, Lord, behold their threatenings. And grant unto thy servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word. God, help us to keep doing what we're supposed to be doing. They didn't ask him to take away the suffering. So many times we do. And sometimes we see that in the Bible. But in this case, they said, would we see their threatenings? God, you see their threatenings. Would you help us to keep sharing the gospel no matter what? Give us boldness. They prayed for boldness to continue through the hardships. They prayed for God to continue working through them. Look at verse 30. By stretching forth thine hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. God, would you please keep working through us? Would you keep using us? Would you keep using us to share the gospel with people and let people keep getting saved? And in verse 31, I want you to see that they received answers to their prayers. And when they prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they spake the word of God with boldness. They're praying. They're praying for boldness. They're praying in unity. They're praying for God to keep using them. And then God answers them. This is an instant answer to prayer. They're praying. God answers them. The place is shaking. What a prayer meeting that must have been. praying until they knew they got a hold of God, because the place was shaken. God, the Bible says, fills them with the Holy Ghost. And then the Bible says they spake the word of God with boldness. God filled them to use them, and they go out and they keep sharing the word of God. What do you do after the resurrection? Well, we're faithful to assemble. Keep coming to church. Be faithful to share the gospel. Keep telling people about Jesus. Be faithful to follow up with new converts. Let's follow up with them at their house. Let's follow up with them getting them to church. Let's follow up with them showing how they can grow as Christians. Be faithful to have a good testimony among non-believers. There may be somebody that you invited to come to church today that didn't come to church today. Don't get mad at them for not coming. Love them. Keep investing in them. Keep loving them. You never know when the wall comes down and they're going to make a decision for Christ. Be faithful to have a good testimony among non-believers, and be faithful to pray. Resurrection is awesome. Looking at what Jesus did, he brought himself out of the grave. And the songs we sang today, up from the grave he arose. This is a wonderful, wonderful thing. But it's not done. It's just the beginning. It's a whole new season. I don't know if this is a good term, but it's post-resurrection season. It's a great time to get out. It's a great time to keep coming to church. It's a great time to stay faithful. It's a great time to share the gospel. It's a great time to follow up with converts. It's a great time to get involved and really see God do something. I'd like to invite you to be part of that. Father, thank you for letting us be part of this church. Thank you for all you've done today. Thank you for all you've done in our lives. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to do what you want us to do as we move forward. Resurrection Sunday was wonderful. We saw many people saved today. But Lord, I pray that you'd help us to do what we're supposed to do. Keep us faithful. Help us to keep sharing the gospel. Help us to be good witnesses and good examples and have good testimonies. And help us to keep praying. I pray that you'd help us to be in one accord. Be able to pray in unity as one church and one body. Asking you to be involved in what we're doing here as we serve you and do your will.